This film is about living in Auschwitz. It is about one woman who survived.
Now, I have got to take some pictures of the upper part of your neck. Yeah. I'm sorry, I've got to ask you, have you any dentures?
No.
No? No one's knocked them out? No one's knocked your teeth out?
No. Still
do you play rugby?
Yes.
And no one's knocked your teeth out? Well, you're lucky, aren't you?
Kitty Hart is a radiographer. She lives and works in Birmingham. For 6 years, as a young girl, she fought for her life against the system the Nazis had created to destroy her and all those like her. For 2 of these years, she was a prisoner in Auschwitz. Now, after 34 years, Kitty Hart has decided to go back to Auschwitz to try to begin to explain what happened and how it happened and how it was possible to go on living at all.
Breathe on now. Good. That's one.
Super.
Kitty was born in 1926 in Bielsko, a small town in southwest Poland. Her father, Karl Felix, was a successful merchant and ran the family business. His wife, Lola, was a practical and well-educated woman. She had a talent for languages and devoted some of her time to teaching English. Kitty and her elder brother, Robert, in 1937. By this time, Kitty had a reputation as a tomboy. She was mischievous, competitive, and always getting into trouble.
Oh, I was a terrible child. I did the most ghastly things at school and used to be thrown out of the class, always. I used to be sent home from holiday homes. Yeah, because I'd get out in the night and ski at night and everybody was asleep. I never really obeyed any rules whatever, whether it was at home or at school. I was always a... You know, my marks as far as behavior were always, there was always a cause for complaint.
When she was 9, Kitty was sent to the convent school of Notre Dame. It was an expensive and fashionable school which catered for the daughters of Bielsko's more prosperous citizens. Her school reports continued to show a talent that was athletic rather than academic. It was the end of the summer term, 1939. This report is the last that Kitty would ever receive from the Sisters of Notre Dame. It is also the only documentary evidence remaining that the Felix family had ever lived in Bielsko. When the Germans invaded Poland in September 39, Bielsko was immediately threatened. The Felix family fled to Lublin. A month later, the victorious Nazi army had caught up with them.
I'd never seen Germans before, and I thought they looked absolutely splendid. They had these fantastic uniforms and black boots, and I remember them marching across the city with the sergeant major, you know, waving his baton and conducting a military band, and I was most fascinated. And my father used to run after me and pull me home and not allow me out. And I couldn't understand why. I thought, oh, these marvelous soldiers, why am I not allowed to go and see them? And so I used to sneak out and just watch the parades. The fact that the Germans were out to kill people like me came to me very suddenly. There was one very important rule, and this was that when soldiers walked along the town, the city, the pavements, everybody else had to get off the pavement. And I walked along the pavement with this boy. And I instinctively got off the pavement, and he didn't get off the pavement. And one of them pulled out his gun and shot him through the head. And there was this friend of mine just dropped dead. And this was the, you know, and I ran home and said this. And this was the very first moment that I realized they were out to kill.
To escape the German terror that had now begun, Kitty's brother Robert fled to Russia in an attempt to reach England. Her grandmother, who had been in hiding with the family, was seized by a Nazi extermination squad. Now Carl Felix made his last and most desperate bid to keep his family alive. It was to separate him from them forever. He arranged new Aryan identities for his wife and daughter, and then smuggled them on board a train taking Poles to Germany for forced labor. Kitty and her mother were taken to the IG Farben works at Bitterfeld. A year later, the Gestapo were tipped off that amongst the Polish laborers, there were some Jews.
The Gestapo people came in civilian clothes. They were not in any uniform. There was this man in civilian clothes. He came in and said, tomorrow we're having dancing. We're all going to have a dancing lesson. And it's just the way he said it, we knew automatically we're going to die. There was something in his barking sort of voice, that put it across. He did say, you might as well say goodbye to one another, because tomorrow we are having a dancing session. And then we were taken out at dawn and put up against a brick wall, and all the machine guns were lined up, and the soldiers were there ready to shoot. And shots were fired. And my very first impression was that I had been missed, because I was facing the wall, and there were screams. And then it was very quiet, you see. And all of a sudden there was this terrible laugh from beyond, and we'd realized that they were not going to shoot us. It was just to frighten us. And of course, many of us broke down and cried, and I don't remember crying. I just felt a tremendous relief that I hadn't actually been struck.
From Bitterfeld, Kitty and her mother were transferred to another prison in Dresden. And it was here they got their first idea of what was in store for them.
There were various rumors about Auschwitz, that whoever goes there never comes out. There were inscriptions on the walls, I'm on my way to hell. I didn't relate this to any hell. To me, hell was having been on the run for 3 years. And I thought, well, here we come to a place, there will be our enemy, and we will have something to fight.
Kitty and her mother were transported back to Poland. They arrived in Auschwitz on April the 2nd, 1943. Kitty was now 16. She had been on the run since she was 12.
Although I was psychologically ready for Auschwitz when I got there the very first time, I'm not quite sure whether I'm psychologically ready to go and face it this time. I don't know what it will do to me to see it. I don't know if I'll be as detached as I was when I got there in the first place, when I knew I had to face death or life or death. To see it now may make a very much bigger impression on me than what I expect. I would like my son David, who is a doctor working in Canada, to come over and see it for himself, because he so much wanted to see it and so much wanted to understand how people could live there. Maybe I should go back, because very soon there will no longer be people like me alive. In another 30 or 40 years, there will be no one who can actually say, well, I have seen 1, 2, 3 million people die. And I would like my son to be able to say, my mother was there, and I am telling my children what my mother saw, and I feel it is my duty to go back, even though I'm psychologically not ready for it. feeling slightly sick inside, that's all.
Right. Just... let's go for the hill.
What Christmas may it come be, David?
Hmm?
I don't think I can... oh, God.
Pretty vast, isn't it?
Well, just wait and see. Just wait and see. Oh, God, I don't know where bloody hell I am. Now, wait a minute, wait a minute. I can't also find my bearings here. Now, you know one of the reasons you're here, don't you?
What's that?
Well, just look at this terrible emptiness. Just, can you imagine this place full of people?
I can imagine. I can imagine it's in the winter with the snow as well. Are those, that's where the fence used to be. Okay.
Just let me compost myself. Perhaps I've come to speak for all the people who died, but it's most important now. Do you know why? Because there are people in this world, they say that this has never happened. They're writing about it. They're saying, oh, this has all been, you know, it's not true. You are here just to see that it is true, it was true. And so that when you have children, you can bring them here and tell them about this. And I owe this to all the people that have died. I'm sure I do. 30 members of your family have died here. Your grandfather, your grandmother, my family, all my school friends. Everybody out of our hometown. All your father's family, everybody's ashes are here, so let's just go and see if we can find something now. I think this is B1. I don't remember coming in through this, no. These railway lines weren't here, you see, in 1943.
Well, do you think they've been put here since?
Oh, yes. I came in the middle of the night, and I didn't come through this gate. I think I came through some side gate. And these are the rails that I helped to build.
And is this where the fences were, is it?
Oh, the fences were. The whole place was lit up when I came here.
Yeah.
And there was a kind of smell of roasting meat. And you thought, God, surely there can't be roasting a lot of meat here. And there was a peculiar glow in the distance. And you thought, well, what the bloody hell is this glow? Still, we went on and... as I said, it was the middle of the night. You didn't really know where you were, except for the whole sort
what
of the stench.
What was over there? Were those brick?
I'm trying to find Camp B1, and I think you go through there. Now, these railway lines were built, and they go all the way to the end. And the people came in here. The trains were brought in there, you see. But before that happened, before, people came along here. They just walked along. Now, were you walking along here? Just imagine, hundreds and thousands and millions of people walked along this road here with their bundles, tiny children, old people, some had to be thousands and millions of people walked along this road here with their bundles, tiny children, old people, some had to be carried, and they just walked all the way to the end. I haven't got my bearings, but I think this is B1. I think there's got to be a way in here. Just look at it. As far as you can see, you'll see camps. 22 camps. Not just one camp. We're talking about the tiniest, weeniest section, which is this. I worked on this railway. Now, the worst thing you could do was working outside. And I helped to build this railway. I actually didn't lay the rails. I carried the cement. That's why my hands are not ladylike, because I carried the cement and carried enormous big stones. And that's where the dogs came and were let loose on you. And that's where I was bitten. You see my scar here, don't you?
Yes.
Anyway, I'd like to be able to find my way in. Now, there's an entrance. There's got to be an entrance. And don't take any notice of the grass, because there was no grass.
Well, what was in...
All this was mud. Just a sea of mud. Damp. It was damp in the summer.
And so what's full of snow in the winter?
Thick with snow in the winter. And it was always wet, and your feet were always stuck in the mud. Sometimes as far as the calf. So this grass has been laid since.
And there was just this one road approaching through.
Well, this was the main road to bring the people to the gas chambers, this very road. David, this was the most important place of all. See this gate?
Yeah.
Let me tell you about this gate. Now, the commandant stood here, the SS women, that's where they stood. People came to work, external work, from there, from the camp. 5 o'clock in the morning, the groups went out to work, outside, digging trenches, doing what you like, right? People who went that way never came back, right? So this was the way of life.
To the crematorium?
That's the way to the crematorium, right? So here, if you were brought in through this gate, you could live for a bit. But if you went that way, you never lived. That was the end. That was the way to die. If you managed to stay in this enclosure, you could still live a little longer, right? Here, somewhere here, was the orchestra. A full orchestra, right? Just imagine it. Prison orchestra.
Yeah.
Alma Rose conducting. She was a very famous musician. She died. Let's find our bearing here. Now, I came here during the night. Now, I went into a place called the saunas, sauna, right? Where everything was taken from you. That was your very first thing that happened to you. Everything was taken off you, and you were shaved, naked, smeared with some kind of green fluid, and we were given prisoner of war uniforms. There were 20,000 Russian prisoners of war that were shot here just before I arrived, and we were given their uniforms. By that I mean their trousers and their tops, and you were only allowed to wear one layer. So you had nothing else. No underwear, remember? I would like to find Block 25, because Block 25 had the most terrible significance. The selections to the gas chambers were carried out weekly. Oh.
There's a number on the brick there, isn't there?
Is that?
Am I right?
Well, perhaps we'll
have to cross. There's something written on there.
Let's just go across.
23, is it? Not so.
73. It's 25 we're looking for. Now, you picture here bodies. Just bodies, and you can picture people being beaten up here the whole of the time. I mean, we were walking in an emptiness. You must picture here a continuous shifting population, because people died and more people were being brought in from all over Europe. So we're looking, this Block 27.
And this is 20. This is Block 20.
Now, this was my block. I was here for months and months in this block, and that's where I hid, actually, because I pretended I belonged to a group of workers in Siemens, and I didn't. So I slept there during the day, and I slept there during the night. I walked in through this here, through this entrance. As you walked in, you got your bread ration. So I got my bread, and here were the roll calls. You see, everybody was standing here. 1,000 women standing in front of each block twice a day, right? Here stood the block älteste, the woman in charge of the block. That's where you're beaten as you got in. Every time you got in, you got beaten. And every time you got in, you got your bread ration. You went in, and let's go inside. Ah, that was my block. Now then. I often bought myself a place to sleep here, you see. Bought myself with my crumb of bread a place to lie on one of these boards. Because if you didn't, you had nowhere to sleep. You was here. Look at the mud. Just look.
Yes.
That's it, barefoot
and
sometimes.
And it was as dirty as it is up on
there. Oh, it was worse, because people couldn't go to the toilet.
There were no toilet facilities.
No toilets. It was a bucket at one end, But you had to fight to get to the bucket, or you had to have permission to use the bucket. And mostly you couldn't use the bucket, so you were lying in your own mess and everybody else's mess, right? Now, it was very easy to lose the desire to live, let me tell you, very easy. So don't be surprised when people gave up, because you live like this for just a few days, yeah, without water, without food, and you're beaten all the time, and no change of clothes. And how long do you think you want to live?
Exit up there? That was
oh, that was just to let a bit of light in, but no light. It was pitch dark in here at night.
Yes.
Yeah. 1,000 women in here in the total darkness trying to find somewhere to sleep, right? Every night, not just one night. Now, let's just go and see here. Now then, sometimes there was a bit of water here, but 1,000 women trying for a drop of water. Now, I don't remember this, because I never, ever managed to get as far as this. I washed in my urine, David. That's where I washed, you know? And what's more, you had to keep your body clean, because if selections were carried out, you see, the SS came in here, everybody had to get down, strip. And then they looked you over, and if you were dirty and you had some sort of, and even if you were too thin, your number was taken down, and you never heard anymore. You know, this was the end. You thought, oh, they've just taken your number for some reason. Perhaps you get a flogging. But it wasn't so. A few days later, all the numbers were called out, and you were taken to block 25. Anyway, that's where I lived, David, for 2 years. No, not quite. I'm exaggerating. 1.5 years. Now, in the mornings, 4 o'clock in the mornings, you were driven out from there, and you stood here. So, in fives, here you were counted, and you can imagine that people kept on going to different blocks, because, you know, they got mixed up. It's not always that you found your way to your block quickly enough. So you stood outside somebody else's block. Oh, boy, if numbers didn't match up, you stood until the numbers matched up, sometimes 3 hours, 4 hours, right through the night. In the meantime, bodies were lying along here, you see, because people just collapsed and died. Ha! This must be block 25, because it's got the bars. And I don't need to see a number, because I can see the bars. Now, when selections were carried out to the gas chambers, people were stripped, mostly, they were stripped. Naked, put into there, block 25. Now, everybody kept away from here because through the bars you could see hands sticking out. Hands of people sticking out, begging just for a drink, because they were naked there, sometimes 3 days, 4 days, waiting to die, waiting to be taken to the gas chambers. People that have perhaps survived the camp for 6 months, 8 months, 10 months, not just coming from home. Whoever went through there never, never, ever came out. You just couldn't get anybody out. Hands were sticking out here, day and night, begging just for a sip of water, so that they could...
Oh, they didn't give them anything?
Nothing. 3 days, 4 days, sometimes a week. And sometimes when they opened up the doors, the stench was such that you could smell it right through the camp. A lot of my friends, when they could no longer live, went on the fence. And when I say went on the fence, the slightest touch of the fence and you'd committed suicide. And if you touched this person, you committed suicide too. Yeah. You were allowed to walk as far as the trench. You were allowed to walk, but if you passed the trench, you were shot at. Because they didn't really want you to commit suicide. They wanted to kill you off here. Now, I think what we ought to do, I must tell you about the toilets. Because when I came here, there were no toilets and there was no water. No water whatever. Eventually, they laid on water, you see. When I came first, there was no water. But the prisoners built everything, of course, in here. So all you had was your tea that you got in the morning, and that if you could drink it, which I couldn't, because every time I drank it, I had a diarrhea. So I couldn't drink it. I used to wash myself. I don't know, it was dark blue and it contained bromide or something to poison you. So I didn't drink it. So there was no water and there was absolutely nothing. No soap, no water, no change of clothes. You soon lost your will to live, David. It was very, very easy. Believe you me. You see, I had realised one very important thing. Well, one of the best things to do in this camp was to do nothing. just be invisible. Just, you know, hide. I mean, there were 50,000 to 100,000 people here, so you could hide behind people if you were small, insignificant, invisible, as I try to be. But the other thing I found is one of the best things to do was to carry bodies. Why? I mean, it was very hard work, but A, you worked inside the camp, you didn't do external work, you see, and B, the dead body had a ration bread, piece of bread. The dead body had one change of clothes. And it wasn't any good to this dead body, was it? I mean, I don't have to feel guilty about this, do I?
That's true.
Well, but this is what I thought. Well, I'm not doing anybody any harm. I'm taking this piece of bread from this dead body and I'm taking this one pair of boots and I can sell it. And with this, I can buy myself a place to live. I can buy myself a place to sleep. So this, there you are, I'm right. This, there you are. This is a wash. That's it, it's here. Now, the water was here, and you couldn't get in, because in charge of this was some ruling prisoner with a whip, right? Now, how do you get in? If you want to be beaten up, you could have got in, you see. But if you could give her something, like your bread ration, which I got off my dead body that I loaded, you see. I mean, there were dead bodies, 300, 400 dead bodies.
Didn't you let her in?
So I bought myself a bit of access to go in there. And perhaps just, I couldn't have a wash. I mean, can you imagine 2,000? Well, there were 50,000 in here. And just a few blocks of this, you see. Everybody had to pile in there. You had perhaps the half a minute to get in there and get out. So how do you wash? You couldn't take anything off, because if you took it off, you didn't see it again, so you were left naked. And what happened then? You were as good as dead, because there was no means of getting another pair of anything.
Right, so you went in fully clad.
You went in fully dressed,
yeah.
And you got a bit of water in your bowl. Your bowl was tied to your body.
So your bowl
was your life.
Yeah, if you didn't have your bowl.
If you didn't have your bowl, you didn't have your soup. If you didn't have your bowl, you didn't have your toilet, because your bowl was your toilet. You understand?
Well, how did you wash the bowl out?
You didn't.
Before you ate?
Well, you didn't. You didn't. You didn't wash it out. That was your life, your bowl. My bowl, it was red. Now, you must picture thousands of women trying to get in here. Thousands. I'm not talking about 5, 10. I'm talking about 20,000, 30,000, right?
Let's go in.
See? Show me.
There seems to be a
shoe. Oh, my God. Now... That meant life or death for somebody, I can tell you. Because all you had were wooden clogs. I had wooden clogs all the time. To have a pair of leather shoes would have cost you 15 days bread ration. So either you ate or you had your pair of shoes. Didn't matter if they were like this. They were leather shoes. God, leather shoes. Absolutely fantastic thing to have in this place, a pair of leather shoes. You know, if you took them off at night, you never had them again in the morning. So you slept in your shoes. You slept in all your clothes. I slept in my clothes about 12 months. The very same clothes. You know, if I had managed to get two layers, well, I slept in two layers. Mostly I had paper stuffed inside because I worked
on... Newspaper.
No, there was no newspaper. Oh, newspaper, boy, where did you find newspaper?
What sort of paper?
Well, I carried cement, laying the railway.
There was the
right?
cement from
the
paper.
The cement bags... Paper was very good insulating stuff, and I had it inside my underneath my dress. Let's go right in anyway. Let's just go in here. Now, sometimes you got to this precious tap here, right? Where water dribbled out, and you had a little bit of water, and you took it into your bowl, and then you washed, or you drank it, because there was nothing else to drink. So, it, really, for drinking. If you could get to
was it clean water, was it?
Oh, you didn't worry about clean water. It was wet. I mean, in the winter, I didn't worry about water because I ate the snow. And I washed with the snow. But during the summer, sometimes it was boiling hot and you needed a drink. Now, I don't know whether this was a toilet block or whether It could be. I just go in.
Looks like basins in there like this
one. I don't know. I'm not sure.
What do you think?
No, this is different. No. I think this... this is your toilet.
Before a roll call, you were allowed to go in here. But you only had a few minutes. And you had thousands of women trying to get in there.
Yes.
And those were your
toilets. And no paper or anything like
that. Oh, paper, boy, God. What sort of it? You mean toilet paper?
Yes.
Oh, you must be joking. You were lucky if you could go in there and do something and it didn't go down your legs. And, you know, sometimes during 3 or 4 hour roll call you had to do something. The only time to go to the toilet was when there was a commotion. The whistles blew and you had to go and stand in front of your block. So you thought, now we're going to try and get in there. So if you could possibly get in there, now let's go and see it. Now, one was sitting here, or perhaps three were sitting here, because you couldn't just have one hole to yourself. So you had so you were sitting sort of like this, and somebody else was sitting there, you see. And then before you finished, somebody pushed you off, because the other one wanted to go, you see.
Yeah.
That's right, and all this, there you are. That's
well, they had these metal...
Listen, just as you see it.
Wasn't this metal thing here?
Well, I couldn't tell you what this is, but then somebody had to work in the Scheisskommando. Now, the Scheisskommando, God, it's too bloody funny, really. The Scheisskommando was a work group, people who had to dig that stuff out, put it in buckets, and carry it to the cesspool. Now, I worked on the Scheisskommando for some time also, because I've worked in both work parties here, and the Scheisskommando was very good, because you had a bar at the back here, and two buckets. And then you sort of carried the shit in each bucket, you see, across the shoulder, and you carried it to the cesspool. It was emptied at the back there. So you carried the shit, actually. You had to empty this into buckets and carried it. And that was a very good work party, because, you see, you were actually working inside the enclosure of the camp. It was very prestigious to be in the Scheisskommando. Somewhere there must be some wooden hut, which was the quarantine. Now, that's where you were initiated into the camp. Now, the quarantine block was just a stable with 1,000 women inside. Imagine each one of these holding at least 1,000 people. You can't imagine it. That's where I spent my first night. Now, my first night was spent here in one of these somewhere, and I don't think it was on the top, I think it was somewhere in the center. It was best if you could lie on the top, because at least you had a bit of air. But you see, sometimes you couldn't, you had to lie down there. There were about 1,000 people in here, 1,000 women. They had already been in here a few days, and some were dead, some were sitting on here. My mother and I, we scrambled onto here somewhere, and I was lying next to some woman, and it turned out she was a gypsy, you know, and she looked at me, and she sort of looked at my hands, and she said, "You're going to come out."
I thought, oh, Maria, what the heck is she talking about? I'm going to come out. She's looking at my hands. And I think there was a psychological thing. It stayed with me really right through. I kept on saying, this gypsy said to me, I'm going to come out. So I've got to live because she said so. Anyway, I slept right through the night because I was terribly tired. There'd been no food for about 48 hours because we'd come from prison. And we'd missed the bread ration, you see, because that was only given out in the evening. And we'd came in almost during the morning, but this was dark. Anyway, I think the day had to be spent outside, but the evening was here. And I'm talking about my first night. And I slept next to this gypsy. And I was terribly cold at night, you see. And because we only had one layer of clothes, and those were the Russian uniform, just a sort of a khaki affair. No, my head had been shaved, and then, you know, I'd never been without hair, so I was terribly cold. And I didn't know why I was so cold. And then a whistle blew, and everybody started rushing out this very first morning. And I shook this woman, you see, and she was cold, you see. And she died in the night, and she was dead for some hours, and this is why I was so cold, because she was dead. Yeah. And so I said to my mother, I said, now look, she's dead. I know what has got to be done. We've got to have her clothes, and we've got to have her bread ration if she's got one, because it's not good to her. And then it came to me that this was the way to live. You must have it off the dead. And this was the principle that I adhered to all the time, that you must take off the dead. You must never, never take anything off the people that are alive. But it's yours if the people are dead. You must take advantage of this. Yes. And so my very first things, I stripped this gypsy, I stripped off everything she had. And so both my mother and I had almost immediately a second layer of clothes and a second bread ration when it was necessary to have. Now, let me tell you, the hospital blocks were exactly the same. This is what made me cry, because the hospital blocks were like this, and all that remains over there on the hospital compound are the chimneys. But my mother was in charge of this gate at some night. And the purpose was not to allow anybody out, because everybody, you know, especially the sick, try to get out. But I've got out one night, I got out, because I was determined to heat this bloody thing up.
And how did you manage that?
Well, I saw a heap of wood, and I crawled along, and I got this piece of wood. I got as far as it, I got in, actually. But of course I was followed, and I think I have told you before, I had a public flogging, 25 strokes. And the whip wasn't just one whip with one piece of leather. There were about 25 pieces of leather, so every time you had one stroke, you already had 25. So this is why I have got one or two scars where my flesh just opened up. But anyway, nonetheless, many, many times we achieved the thing and heated this thing here. I'm not sure whether this is this end or the other end, but one end you could actually heat it.
Yeah.
Now, when you did heat this, this became lukewarm.
So then people used to sit all
then along. You were sitting along that, but that didn't last very long. So this was the heating channel, but it rather shook me, you know, because I've spent many nights sitting on this heating channel, actually, when I couldn't find anywhere to sleep. All this was the hospital section. All this vastness, you see, each one of these was a wooden block. You see, your grandmother only survived because she worked on the hospital block. Now, I know you're seeing grass, but I don't see grass. I see mud, just a sea of mud. And believe you me, if there was one blade of grass, you know what would have happened? You would have eaten it. My mother worked in block 12. That was the infectious block. Typhus, dysentery, scarlet fever, diphtheria. Now, I know block 12 because, you see, from block 12, you could actually see people walking along this street to the crematorium. It was right up against the fence, so this must be block 12. It doesn't say anywhere. You know, you have got no like indication. She's all been taken away and burnt. But you just look at the size of this, from there to there, and this housed about 1,000 women in here, and the death toll was, 500-600 a night. So all day long you carried out the bodies of from the night before.
Was it a good job for a prisoner to work in the infectious?
Well, if my mother hadn't worked in here, she would not have lived 2 days. Now, all this was quarantine, as you know.
Yeah.
And on the very last day of the quarantine, a girl came over that comes from our hometown, and she promised to come at the end of the quarantine period. And of course, she did come. It had to be paid for that she came. I had to pay in bread. But she came and she took her mother away, and she said, I've got a job for you in this hospital block, on this here 12th. Block 12, which was the typhus block,
yeah.
And she was here right through, working as a sort of a nurse, but of course she couldn't nurse anything, there were no
medicines. What were the advantages of having a job in this block?
Well, can you imagine a tremendous advantage? First of all, she didn't have to be outside for the roll call, so she was spared the roll call twice a day, because the sick were not actually taken out to be counted, it was all done inside the block. And the same for the staff, so this was a very, very big advantage, not having to stand outside 3 or 4 hours twice a day.
Yes.
And of course you were sheltered from elements. I mean, it's cold here today, isn't it?
Very cold.
Right, well, what are you wearing? 5 layers of clothes, eh?
Quite a few.
Right, well, you'd imagine people in this here working when it snows, when it rains, when the sun is hot, in the summer and in the winter, 1 layer of clothes, the same layer of clothes day in,
it's
day
almost
night.
Almost unimaginable.
Wet. Yeah. In the wet, and that's, you couldn't fine. Take your clothes off, so it was in order to live, you had to find some way of working indoors, inside, or even inside the camp was better than external.
And how long did my grandmother work in this?
She was here block. Almost throughout. She did tremendous work, because although she couldn't save people's lives in the sense that she had no medicines to give them, but she was such a tremendous woman, as far as now you know, as moral support.
I know.
I mean, you could keep people alive by just talking to them, you see, and begging them to live just one more day. And this is what she did, and she kept me alive by begging me to live another day. And I kept her physically alive by bringing stuff to keep her alive physically, and she kept me alive mentally. So very often, when I was in quarantine, I got away. You see, this was a slave labor market, sort of, when you were in quarantine. And so the four women and the ruling party came to fetch you for work. Now, if you could get away during this commotion after a roll call, I used to find my way into here and straight up onto my mother's bunk, hid underneath a sick person. And that's where I remained throughout the day.
But what I don't understand is, why did they not shoot the infectious and sick patients?
It wasn't like they didn't shoot them. They were selected to die every day. Sometimes the staff had to carry out the people in front here. They were lined up here, and selections were carried out. Now, I went through a selection.
In front of Mengele.
After typhus.
I remember.
Mengele stood there.
Yes,
and I
wearing
came
white out, gloves, if I remember.
Wearing white stuff. Gloves. I came out here, I was after typhus, and I had to strip naked and run. If you couldn't run, well, you were selected to go to the other side. But of course, I was after typhus, and I couldn't run at that time. I was still crawling. I was actually on my knees. As far as here, I was on my knees. And my mother said, now, you've got to go. You've got to stand, and you've got to run. You see, and I did. I ran in front of him, and then he pointed that way. So I lived. So you're a doctor, you know what happens during typhus, but you are mentally deranged. This is part of the symptom of typhus. I was mentally deranged for about 3 months, I think. And one of the symptoms was that everybody had hallucinations, and imagined that at the bottom of your bed were all these fantastic fruits and juices, and nobody wants to give it to you. And I used to scream, apparently, and my mother had to strap me to make sure that I stay on this bank. And one day there was a selection. Actually, Mengele came in, and there was a selection
Within the hut.
Yes. And my mother took me, put me underneath a straw mattress and put another body on top of me. I was unconscious at that time.
So she saved your life.
And she saved my life because everybody that was lying on the bank, on the bunk, was taken to be gassed. Everybody. And if I hadn't been underneath, well, I would not have survived. I began to recover from typhus, but my health just didn't pick up. And I was completely deaf. And a prisoner doctor decided that the only way to get over this deafness was to pierce my ears. But of course there were no instruments, so there were two knitting needles, and they pierced my ears with knitting needles.
I remember you telling me that.
That's right. Yes. Now then, I was ready to be thrown out, you see, and I would have had to go back onto external work. Mm. And it was, again, buying your way into some sort of position, and eventually I managed to buy my way in to stay and work
in the dysentery block,
I think I worked, which I think was the next block, the dysentery block, and after that was the TB block.
Yeah.
Now I stayed and worked here. I worked as a putzerka, which was just sort of an orderly, carrying out bodies, and that was very, very difficult because bodies were on the top bunk, threw it down, pulled it all along here, and then the lorries, and then all the bodies were just sort of heaped up, you see. You got quite accustomed to bodies just lying heaped up, and then we had to load the bodies. Two people loaded the bodies. Just give me your hands and I show you. You should do like this.
Yes.
Two, one,
and then three.
Three, throw.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
it. And I the see. Bodies were loaded on, yeah. Right? Now, I stayed on like this for some time, and lots and lots of my friends came in, and I nursed one of my cousins. On my father's side came in and I nursed this cousin, and she died.
Yes, I remember my grandmother
she died,
telling me that.
And one or two aunts of mine that died here on this block and on that block. And then I had two friends that we'd saved from a selection from prison, two girls, two sisters, and they had survived already 8 months, you see. And one day Mengele came in and he said, the whole block's going to be emptied. Everybody out. So all the staff, that was I was staff by then, we had to ring this area. I think there was this block over there. We all stood around here. We were standing around. They brought all the people out, and we were standing holding hands, you say, like this, so that they couldn't escape. And all the sick, even the convalescents, they were well. They were already well.
But why did he want to clear the block?
He wanted to clear the block because there were lots of new sick ones coming in. So he cleared the whole block, and everybody had to be loaded on, and I had to load my friends on. And that finished me. And that really finished me mentally, I think. That finished me, I'm sure it did. But it was my mother that stopped me going on the fence that day. Everybody went. Everybody.
You mean you wanted to commit suicide that day?
Well, I just didn't want to live. You see, all my friends were on this block, and they were well. And I'd been here a year, 12 months. And then I had to load them up, you see. And I wanted to go with them. But of course, they'd stopped me. You see, my mother came out and she just grabbed me and stopped me.
It's really yet another occasion when she saved your life.
Oh, yes. During that period, she saved my life, yes. Oh, we could not have survived without each other. There's no doubt about that. Yeah. You couldn't have lived on your own. You had to have somebody to help for you to survive, and you had to help somebody else. I don't know about the men. I couldn't tell you how the men managed to survive. But conditions in the women's camp were 1,000 times worse than conditions in the men's. Because of the overcrowding. I don't know. I think they were afraid to have too many men. And then they didn't mind about having so many women. And then we were all told, now you have to go and work externally again, you see. And all of a sudden, they came in and said they were going to form a new commando. And if we like, we can join it. And it was the Canada commando. It represented food, drink, everything that you needed. Because all the possessions that people have brought in that came along here were down there. And my mother said, well, you must. She thought, if I could just live one day and taste some food just once while I live, then it was worthwhile.
Early in 1944, Adolf Eichmann visited Auschwitz and ordered the camp commandant to prepare for the arrival of even greater numbers of people for extermination. As a direct result of this order, Kitty Hart, by this time just 17 years old, was taken from the women's camp to work in the Canada Commando. Canada was Auschwitz slang for an isolated section of the camp near the gas chambers, where, it was said, there was an abundance of everything. In reality, it was where the clothes and belongings of Nazi victims from all over Europe were sorted and packed for shipment to Germany.
Now, this is a Canada Commando enclosure here. This was all pretending to be a garden, pretending to be a factory. It was all a pretense, you see, because they didn't want people to panic when they brought them in here. This patch of that you see here, this piece of grass, was actually lawn. Along here was a fence. Beyond this fence, along the road, walked the people either to the sauna to live, or they came the other way from the ramp and to the crematorium over there, which is crematorium 4. The people were told to leave all their stuff behind, that they're going to be disinfected, they're going to be taken into the camp.
And they didn't realize what was going on?
Well, they thought people were having a bath, a shower, because it said to the showers, please leave your clothes neatly in a bundle and bundle your shoes together so that they don't get lost. But this was just to help us here to sort out the remains. I don't remember this tree. But at the bottom there was this enormous heap of all the stuff that the people brought. Our job was to get a wheelbarrow full of stuff, take it into one of the working barracks, and everything was sorted out. Yes, well, I think these are the remains of the Canada Commando huts. The toilets were away from the blocks, and we were permitted to use the toilets. Believe it or not, it had a door, and you were, for one thing, you had a privacy to sit on the toilet. Now, this toilet, it was situated somewhere at the back here, and possibly the next block had a toilet too. And this was my very favorite spot, that when I found some jewelry or some gold, I was determined that whatever I find is not going to be handed over to the Germans. I buried it, not for myself, but to, first of all, to preserve it, because this gold and the jewelry that was found here was very useful to the men, so that they could buy ammunition, because we knew that sooner or later there had to be an uprising and somehow it had to be paid for. Now, David, where you're standing now is the foundation of my block where I actually lived. Now, in front of it here was this tiny little patch of lawn, and that really was lawn. I'm not joking, it was lawn, right? And it was a glorious summer, and I was on night shift, so during the day when I didn't sleep, I sat here on this lawn sunbathing, with all the screams around, with the people walking past, with the chimney smoking, but we lay down here and we were sunbathing. And it was so hot that we were splashing ourselves with water, which we had access to. Somebody went over to the sauna, got a bucket of water, poured it over, and we were laughing and joking, sunbathing here. Now, you were lying, I was lying here, and I was watching over to this crematorium over there. You saw the SS men, the extermination squad, that did the actual killing, you know, the actual gassing. So, now, somewhere there was a ladder. You could see it when you were lying here. And up this SS man climbed up the ladder with a tin of gas, which he had in his hand, and through the skylight he just dropped in this tin, and then he quickly ran down down the steps, and off he went. And then a few seconds later you heard a sort of a muffled sound, and those were people actually suffocating.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was quiet. And then soon after that, you lay here and you could see actual smoke coming out of the chimney, and those were the very people that were burning.
And the SS men used to pick up the bodies and throw them in the oven?
Oh, no, no. This was done by the prisoners themselves, called the Sonderkommando. And there were, I don't know how many commandos there were, but they were exterminated ever so often themselves. And the 12th Sonderkommando actually blew up this very crematorium that you see here, the remains of. That was blown up while I was here on the 7th of October. And of course we were all implicated, as you know. Yes. And the gold, which we found, helped to buy the ammunition to blow up this crematorium.
And do you think I could believe that there were people actually burning in there? I couldn't believe it. Can you believe it?
No, but
people were burning, and you could hear them scream, but you still couldn't believe it.
What did you think was happening to them?
Oh, I knew, but I made myself believe that I didn't know. I didn't want to know, because if I did want to know, I couldn't have lived one day, could I? From the whole of Europe were brought here. Now this is a graveyard, now just remember that, this is a graveyard. People were sitting all around here, waiting to die. I'm looking for something, known as the White House. At the moment I can't see anything. I think we're coming now to a clearing, and I think it had to be somewhere there. And I passed it on my way going to see my mother. And I think it's got to be somewhere here now. Yes, I think we're coming out of the wood. My mother had typhus at that time, and it was most important for me to have got into the camp to get some medicines and buy food for her, because at that stage I saved her life and life of many of my friends, and it was only possible if I could bring stuff in. This was arranged by our couple, because she was friendly with the SS woman, and it was quite a sort of a reasonable SS woman who took us around here, because she thought she'd give us a treat and a walk, you see. Yeah. Via woods which we could otherwise never have seen. And this is how we come to be around this area. You know, people that were killed off here were burned in those
carried
pits.
Carried out into the pits.
And somewhere here, there must be enormous big pits. Now let's just see, because I passed these pits, you see, on the way to the camp. And I think they might just be down there. Let's just go and have a look. Yeah. I think so. Yes, well, that's a pit. Yes. Yes, I'm quite sure. Now, this is where people were burned alive, David, just believe it or not. Now, if you were brought in here and you would have seen all this beautiful wood, you're seeing it now in the autumn, but in the spring, with flowers all round, girls lying on the lawns there, and perhaps even having some bit of music and laughing, would you think you were going to die in this pit here? It's only when I heard them scream that I realized they were actually burning. So I can't cry over this anymore, I'm afraid. It's just, you know, beyond tears. But that's a graveyard. All this is a graveyard. I think this is a pit too. There must be more pits. There wasn't just one pit. Ashes must be here, but time has taken its toll, and I think the ashes are down here. Yes. Look at this. This is ash. Can you see it? This is ashes. Look. These are remains, body remains.
This is bone, all right. Put the trabeculation on the bone. Can you see those?
Well, we shall wash it and you will see if it is bone, but I think it probably is, yes. This represents a small proportion of the 4 million, and perhaps your grandparents.
Towards the end of 1944, with the advance of the Russian army, the Germans, in common with their practice at other death camps, attempted to destroy all evidence of what had taken place at Auschwitz. Surviving prisoners began to be transported to concentration camps inside Germany.
David, you asked me how many times did my mother save my life. Yes. Well, I will tell you when she really saved my life. And that was, she was working over there in the hospital block, as you know, and I was working in a crematoria.
Yeah.
Now, one day, because she was waiting for days and days and days to try and catch the camp commandant, and the camp commandant was Hessler at that time. It was Hess, it was Kramer, but that was Hessler.
Yeah.
And she waited, and she made a decision. She was going to speak to Hessler herself. Now, this was the greatest feat that you could imagine of heroism for an ordinary prisoner to be able to get near an SS commandant. Now, she waited apparently for days. Now, I didn't know all this because I was working in the crematoria. And somewhere here, he came along, and she ran out from one of these huts here. She must have been hiding at the back of this last block. And she saw him. And of course, he wasn't on his own. He was surrounded, and there were by the ruling prisoners, and you couldn't get near. You had to speak via the ruling prisoners. Anyway, she apparently came up here, and she said, "Prison number 39934 begs to speak to the camp commandant." And he apparently just stood, you know, he was a bit surprised. An ordinary prisoner had come to address him. No.
Yeah.
And he said yes. And she then said, "My daughter has been working at the crematoria for 8 months. And now their transport's leaving, and I would like her to come and join me on the transport." Well, he didn't say yes or no. He just said, "Give me her number." And she said, 39934, dismissed. And that was it. And I never heard any, I didn't know this, you see. But this saved my life. He saved my life. And how he saved my life, I will tell you. Because I worked in the crematoria, and there was this enormous uprising, and I was there when the crematoria were being blown up. And we were all implicated in this. I mean, we were responsible in some, to some extent, for the blowing up of the crematoria.
Yes.
And there was an enormous inquiry. And during roll call, one of the SS women came in and called 39934. And of course, I thought, right, now I'm going to be killed. Because I knew I was implicated. I had a lot of gold and jewelry. It was all hidden and buried. And somebody must have seen it. So I said, oh, bye. You know, everybody knew I was going to die. But instead, she said to me, "You're going to be two. Be one,
so
sorry,
be
one." So the camp commandant saved my life.
Why do you
because
think he did?
I don't know. He just sent a message, "Get prisoner 39934 to come back here." I don't know. It's the way my mother spoke this perfect
German.
The Germans
admired heroism.
They admired heroism, and they admired the fact that she spoke the most perfect German, and she came in the most civilized way. And she didn't beg. She simply said it straight out. She didn't crawl. She was very determined. She said, "We'd been here almost 2 years." And he was impressed by this, that somebody, especially an old lady like her, old, well enough
55.
For 50s,
yeah.
could have lived here so long. He was impressed, I think.
Yeah.
And so my number was called out, and I have not met anyone from this particular Canada commander that is alive, because I think following this inquiry, they were all guessed. And so I think I'm the only one of this particular Canada commander that is alive today.
The freight trucks and cattle wagons that had brought so many men, women, and children to the gas chambers now began to take surviving prisoners away from Auschwitz. But leaving Auschwitz didn't bring an end to their suffering. They were shunted from one overcrowded camp to another. When there were no trains, they were forced to march over hundreds of miles in conditions of deprivation and brutality worse than anything they had experienced in Auschwitz. Kitty left Auschwitz in a freight truck on November the 11th, 1944. It was 1 month before her 18th birthday. Of the 100 women who were transported with her, only 12 were alive by the time liberation came in April 1945. Amongst those 12 were Kitty and her mother.
I had the impression on leaving Auschwitz that there could never be a place like Auschwitz. However, I was not prepared for the death march which was to come. The worst of the death march was that many of us had to throw away our belongings because we couldn't carry them, and so very soon we were saturated and cold and wet, and there was absolutely no food distributed, and we had to fend for ourselves. And only people who had been to Auschwitz and were prepared to risk their lives every single moment in order to obtain some sort of food could survive. And I thought that
I could not possibly live through these last 6 months, having seen many of the very tough girls who had been in Auschwitz 2 years and even 3 years lag behind during the death march, and were simply clobbered to death by being left behind. We were all clobbered. Of course, I was clobbered on the head and the rifle, but butts have been pushed into my back. But yet, there was always someone who picked me up and pulled me along, if they had any strength. But what really kept me going was seeing my friends who were lying at the roadside and being shot by the guards, and my obsession for revenge became more intense, and this is what kept me going. Not so much my physical strength, but this obsession for revenge, to revenge my friends. Some hours before liberation, on the very day of liberation, one SS officer came into the camp. No one knew why, because he no longer gave orders. He just appeared in the camp, and immediately a whole mob of people threw themselves at him and tore his uniform. And I was terribly weak at that time, and I was just watching the SS stores just across the electrified fans, and there were all these marvelous loaves, you see, staring at me. And of course, I knew I couldn't touch the electrified fans, but I knew that at the moment of liberation, this is where I was going to go, for bread, nothing else. However, there were he was mobbed, this SS officer, and I crept in from the back and noticed that he had a dagger. And at that point, I just grabbed this dagger and I made off. Eventually, he broke loose and he escaped through the gate. And we realized then that the end must be very close. But we're still waiting for this very big explosion. I cannot remember. Many hours we were just sort of sitting looking at the loaves, you see, and at this bread. Everybody just was watching, literally watching the bread, and waiting for a signal that the electricity had been cut and that one could actually get to this bread, although we didn't know where the Allies were, but you know, we thought, well, once you can get across, at least you'd have some food, because it could have been perhaps 10 days without food at that time. And then I do remember someone coming up to me and saying, well, there's some very strange soldiers wandering around outside. And I didn't take any notice. And, you know, I was just watching the bread and waiting for someone to say, you know, the electricity is cut and you can go and get some of this bread. And then eventually, of course, the gate swung open and these soldiers came in. And you know, most of us were very dazed to realize what had happened. We had never seen these particular uniforms before. And of course, there were the Americans who came to liberate us. But at point of liberation, I made a dive for the bread. That I remember very clearly, that a lot of people were very weak and could hardly walk, and they threw themselves at the soldiers. But I threw myself at the SS stores, and I came out with a handful of bread, and I was mobbed, you see, and I succeeded in just having a little tiny piece of bread, which I ran with immediately to my mother, and we just sort of had something to eat after 10 days, and it was the most fantastic feeling, perhaps the best feeling of all, just being able to have some food. My intense feeling of revenge wouldn't leave me, and I felt it wouldn't be satisfied until I actually used the dagger and killed the very first German that I would come into contact with. And with this in mind, I followed the mob through the town of Salzwedel on a rampage, not of looting, but of destruction, and hammered and chopped everything up in every house, not taking away a single item. I didn't have any clothes. I wore nothing underneath my one prison dress, and there was everything to be had, but I simply was not interested. All I wanted to do is destroy everything in my wake and use my dagger in the first German, because purely to avenge my friends that I have seen die during the death march or the post-Auschwitz period, more than anything else. This was so intense, and having got into a house, the place looked deserted. Of course, the population realized that there was a small concentration camp outside and they had disappeared. But we ran into one house, which appeared empty, ran into the basement where you could hear sound of voices, children crying, and there was a group of people, and children were huddled in a corner, and there was a woman, and I think there was a man, and a mob of people, and we all rushed into this basement, and I had this dagger, and everybody said, now come on, you know, here they are, you're going to kill them now. And suddenly, there I was, and I found I couldn't actually throw this dagger. And in this split second, it came to me that, well, if I was going to use this dagger, well, then most certainly the Germans have succeeded in influencing me, and I'm no better than they are if I was going to use this dagger in exactly the same way as someone may have used on me. And I saw this group of people in the corner thinking that, well, perhaps they are innocent, and I was in the same sort of situation not so long ago, huddled in a corner, frightened, and there was all this mob screaming behind me, you know, we'll throw it. And so eventually I threw it, and it hit a door, and I threw it the other way, and I threw myself to the ground, and I found a tremendous sense of relief, because in this split second I suddenly realized, well, it changed me into a complete different person. It fizzled out, in fact, my desire for revenge in this split second.
...1946. After a year of working as interpreters in a displaced persons camp in North Germany, Kitty and her mother set out to create a new life for themselves in England. Of their old life in Poland, nothing remained. In Bielsko, every one of the large and prosperous Felix family had been exterminated. Karl Felix, Kitty's father, had been traced by the Gestapo, arrested and shot. Her brother Robert's attempt to reach England ended in Russia. He was killed fighting with the Red Army at Stalingrad. Kitty's mother would never see Poland again. Instead, she and Kitty, traveling with new papers that still recorded their Auschwitz numbers, came and settled in Birmingham. In 1947, Kitty took up radiography at Birmingham's Royal Orthopaedic Hospital. At the Polish club, she met Ralph Hart, a Polish emigre who had arrived in England just before the war. In 1949, they were married. In the 50s, there were children, David and Peter. Kitty's mother lived with the family until her death in 1974. She had survived the years on the run and the years in Auschwitz. She had lost one family in Bielsko, but had lived long enough to see another grow up and take root in Birmingham.
My mother was the tower of strength behind me and encouraging me, as well as many young people, to go on. Youth was on my side when I was in Auschwitz. It was very much easier for the young people to manipulate the system than for the older people, because the older people, being more mature, thought about more about the situations, whereas the young purely lived by animal instinct, and they didn't have to think. I think that the younger a person is, the more cunning, and the cunning side of personality fades out as you get older, and you're more cunning when you're little, and find ways and means of outwitting people and manipulating a system in a simpler way than when you are mature and you begin to rationalize and think about things. Although a lot of older people have survived, it was very much easier for people of my age to survive. It was very easy to lose the desire to live. You saw this in people's sheer way of the way they walked. They began to walk slowly and develop a kind of a vacant expression on their faces. And it was a gradual process, but once this process took over, you know, these people were doomed and you could not save them anymore. But my mother was absolutely fantastic. She worked in the hospital block and she could recognize this expression in people's faces and used to talk to them. She couldn't give them any physical comfort, but by sheer talking to them, she gave them this extra will to live perhaps through another day. During the 8 months that I worked in the Canada Commando, I saw such a vast number of people being brought in and being killed off that the sheer number of people lost its meaning. It was only when I saw an individual act of cruelty, or or if something happened to one person or one child, that it suddenly brought this whole realization of what was happening there, and it took an enormous effort, constant effort, to drive this thing out of my mind. As long as there was a sea of people, it lost its meaning. But I must emphasize that it was. If something happened to one person, this is what hit me hardest. A child would pick flowers. This particularly is in my mind, or a child was playing with toys, and the mother tried to pacify a child, perhaps knowing full well that preparing it for death. You know, just trying to. Instill some calmness into a child, and perhaps the SS would come and tear this child away and pick it up by its head or by its legs and throw it onto the side and just kill it in front of the mother. This is a kind of perhaps incident which I found very difficult to erase from my mind. When I visited the Canada Commander section of the camp, I was very much afraid whether I will be unable to blot out these events again, as I have succeeded before. It was all brought back to me very much, very clearly, very vividly. And this is what I was afraid of, that I will perhaps at this stage, being more mature and thinking more about it, will be unable to detach myself as I had done previously. And it has affected me very deeply because I did see it all very vividly. But again, my mind has been able to begin. It has taken weeks and weeks after my return from the visit for me to settle down and begin to blot out and detach myself. Looking back at Auschwitz, for me, it was a worthwhile experience, something that I wouldn't want to go through twice in my lifetime, but something I'm extremely grateful I haven't missed because of the things it had taught me and the things that I can apply to my everyday normal lifestyle.
Have I X-rayed you before?
No.
Are you sure? I thought I've seen you before.
I've got a familiar face.
I don't know. It's just that, you know, if I've x-rayed someone before, I can usually tell, even if it's sort of been, you know, 5 years ago. Everyone looks different somehow. Nicer still. Okay? Little breath in, please. Let your breath out. Quite still. Breathe on now, good. Fine, super. Thank you very much. I do my own thing, as it were, and I will not be allowed to be influenced in bringing up my sons, in my ordinary activities. Well, people may think that I'm a freak and I perhaps exercise, which is or ski, which in my time of life I should be sitting about and knitting for my grandchildren. And I don't care what people think about this. I do my own thing because I like to do the opposite of what people expect me to do. Well, Well, I think another reason why people think I'm an oddity is because of my extra activities that I tend to pursue, such as I always feel I have to have a challenge and I have to beat a system. And if there isn't anything to beat, well, I'll look for it in order to beat it, no matter what it is. Even if it means beating my own ability, physical ability, to do a certain physical accomplishment. For instance, I have to prove to myself that I still have a certain amount of self-discipline. And I always have to set out to prove this to myself. And I can only prove it by doing the things I do not like doing, necessarily. And because of this, I do enormous amount of physical exercise, which is very often quite unpleasant. And I don't like it. I do it first thing in the morning when I most certainly don't feel like doing it. And I set myself out to do almost the impossible by saying, well, today I must do 100 knee bends, but tomorrow I'm going to do 200, even if it kills me. Or I will swim a mile, knowing it's the most boring thing to do. But it is a way of proving that I have still got this discipline. It's very difficult to hate a whole nation. You'd have to find some people that you could focus your hate on. There must be some degrees of hate. Whom do you hate less or more? If I was going to hate, well, my children were going to hate the next generation of the Germans, who are as innocent, perhaps, as I was.